soul. This sings my soul, my Savior God to thee.
So we're going to continue our sermon series of divine detours in which we're looking at Genesis 41, verses 1 through 16 this morning. Listen with me as we turn to the Word of God. Genesis 41, starting at verse 1. When 2 years had passed, Pharaoh had a dream. He was standing by the Nile, when out of the river there came up 7 cows, sleek and fat, and they grazed among the reeds. After them, seven other cows, ugly and gaunt, came up out of the Nile and stood beside those on the riverbank. And the cows that were ugly and gaunt ate up the seven sleek, fat cows. Then Pharaoh woke up. He fell asleep again and had a second dream. Seven heads of grain, healthy and good, were growing on a single stalk. After them, seven other heads of grain sprouted, thin and scorched by the east wind. Then the thin heads of grain swallowed up the seven healthy, full heads. Then Pharaoh woke up, and it had been a dream. In the morning, his mind was troubled, and he sent for all the magicians and wise men of Egypt. Pharaoh told him his dream, and no one could interpret them for him. Then the chief cupbearer said to Pharaoh, he said, "Today I'm reminded of my own shortcomings. Pharaoh was once angry with his servants, and he imprisoned me and the chief baker in the house of the captain of the guard. Each of us had a dream the same night, and each dream had a meaning of its own. Now a young Hebrew was there with us. He was a servant of the captain of the guard. We told him our dreams, and he interpreted them for us, giving each man the interpretation of his dream. And things turned out exactly as he interpreted them to us. I was restored to my position, and the other man was impaled. So Pharaoh sent for Joseph. He was brought from the dungeon. When he had shaved and changed his clothes, he came before Pharaoh. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream, and no one could interpret it, but I have heard it said of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. This, friends, is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. So as I said, we are looking at the sermon series Divine Detours, and the main objective, or maybe the main point of this, is you do not arrive at the place God wants you to be in a straight line. There are zigzags in life. It is a zigzagging of life that we are calling in this series detours. The place where God takes you off the beaten path from the road you thought he was going to take you from here to there. He takes you off, and often that's tied to construction. Much like we know detours in our mind, there's either construction or development or cleaning up. And that is the premise of detours we're looking at. Now, detours aren't fun. I don't know any of us in this room that said, oh man, I just go looking for a detour to run into on the road. Detours are not fun. They're not pleasant. They often take longer than the trip was originally designed to take. Because God uses detours to prepare you for the destiny he has for you. Let me say that again. God uses detours to prepare you for the destiny that God has for you. I was thinking about this week, thinking of detours, and there was one instance a couple years ago that Clary and I were actually going home to Kansas for the holiday, and we boarded a plane. We were taken out of LaGuardia. Plane took off. We were on our way to the destination of Kansas City, Missouri. Our plane was a straight line. It was a straight flight from LaGuardia to Kansas City. It's about a three-hour flight. Two-thirds of the way into the flight, the pilot came over the intercom, and he said, there's some storms in Kansas City going on, and we have to be rerouted. He said, so now we're now going to be landing in St. Louis until those storms dissipate. Now, St. Louis was not in my plans. I had not requested it. I hadn't desired it. I hadn't thought about it. I didn't want it. And yet somebody else was in control, and the somebody else who was in control told me that I was not going where I thought I was headed. And somehow we wound up in St. Louis. So we're in St. Louis, and then we find out we cannot get off the plane. So we're on the plane, on the tarmac, and the pilot keeps coming over the intercom, and he's saying, you know, 15, 20 minutes. Hey, sorry, folks, 15, 20 minutes. Hey, 15, 20 minutes. 2 hours later, he comes over the intercom, he says, 15, 20 minutes. For hours, Clary and I sat on that plane on the tarmac in St. Louis. Finally, after hours, they come over, they say, hey, that storm has passed in Kansas City. We're going to leave St. Louis here in a minute. So I buckle my seatbelt, we get on the runway, we start to go, we start to slow down, we turn right around, we come back. Pilot comes over, he says, hey, that storm came back. We cannot land in Kansas City. He said, so we will be taking off in about 15, 20 minutes. We were stuck in Kansas City. My detour had now taken a detour. So once again, they said, you know, things are cleared up in Kansas City. We're going to be leaving St. Louis. I thought, no, you're not going to trick me this time. I left my seatbelt unbuckled. Finally, we get off. The plane takes off. We reach our destination, my destiny in Kansas City. We land. The pilot comes over. And he says, ladies and gentlemen, I have some good news and I have some bad news. The good news is we are in Kansas City. The bad news is there is no gate open for us to get off. You will get off in 15, 20 minutes. I was not in a spiritually good place because I had planned on a 3-hour trip that had turned into a 9-hour endeavor. I had been placed on a detour. Now, there might be some of us here that feel like, hey, this is a story of my life. You plan to be over here by now, but you're in this holding pattern. And you don't know when this plan is going to land. You have no idea when you're going to get off the tarmac or get at least get headed in the right direction. You just have no idea. And so what I want to answer before us this morning is this question. How do you know when it's time to land? How do you know when your detour is over and you're being put back on the path that God has for you? Because the truth is, your detour does have an exit. And that exit of your detour is when your preparation meets God's purpose. Your exit is when your preparation meets God's purpose. It's when they're moving together. You're now moving from detour to destiny when your preparation crosses paths with God's purpose. You see, because while we're on a detour, as God is doing preparation in our lives, he's doing two things. He's preparing us. At the same time, he is preparing the destination he has for us. He is preparing the person over here, and he's preparing the purpose over here. And at one point, he's going to join them together. And the joining of them together is what I'm dubbing as destiny. Now, we're going to dive into the story. And the story this morning, we're going to end up where Joseph is going to be 30 years old. When we started this, he was 17 years old. So he is on a 13-year detour, because you do not go from detour to destiny in a straight line. Sometimes there are delays along the way. But I want to share with you three things to look at. Three things that come out of the story of Joseph. They're kind of landmarks that we look at, and we may begin to think, well, God is going to take me off the detour back to the path that he has prepared for my life. So the first point I want to make, that you know you're getting ready to leave the detour back on the highway to destiny. The first point is when God shatters you of your self-reliance. When God shatters you of your self-sufficiency, rather. So if you have your Bible, look with me at Genesis 40. We find Joseph is in prison. Genesis 40, Joseph is in prison. He has just interpreted two gentlemen's dreams, a cupbearer and a chief baker. Joseph interprets his dreams. He then tells the cupbearer in verse 14, he says, hey, only keep me in mind when it goes well with you. Please do me kindness by mentioning me to Pharaoh and get me out of this jail. And so Joseph feels like it's time to be delivered out of this situation. What he's done is he's interpreted this man's dream. He's told this cupbearer, hey, your dream reveals that you're not going to die. You're actually going to be promoted. He's given the cupbearer good news, and he says, when you get that promotion, remember me before Pharaoh. In other words, Joseph is saying, hey, get me out of the situation. I'm in prison. I don't belong here. I'm tired of being here, and you are my way out. I need you to go to Pharaoh and kind of get me out of this. And it's like God has finally brought somebody into Joseph's life that can help him get out of the situation. But we find out a couple verses later, the cupbearer does get promoted, but he forgets Joseph. He even forgets his name. And so you know you are headed towards destiny and off the detour when it looks like God is creating a way out and then he shuts the door in front of you. When God closes that door. Now, when God closes that door, it's good news in a bad situation. When God slams that door. I was actually on the phone with my brother this week. My brother's going through a bit of a situation, and He's kind of bemoaning the circumstances of his life, and we went over this principle that God sometimes shatters your expectations. God sometimes shatters your self-sufficiency when it looks like he's about to bring you out of your chaos. And we both discovered, now this is how God often works in the Bible. And coming to this principle, it did not change my brother's situation, but it changed my brother while in that situation. When it looks like God is going to deliver you, he's going to turn things around, and then all of a sudden he slams that door shut. It's actually good news when that happens, because God is setting you up for where he's about to take you. So that raises a question, Pastor Colby, why is that good news? Why is that good news? Well, let me ask you, has anyone sitting here ever been disappointed by God? You can raise your hand. Anyone ever been disappointed by God? You thought God was going to work it out this way. You thought God was preparing things for this direction. And it, just the opposite happened. It looked like you're going here, and then all of a sudden God comes out of left field and God disappoints you. Now that feels bad, but that's actually a good sign, and let me tell you why. Because when God brings you to your destiny, God does not want to share credit with you. When he brings you to the purpose he has of your life, he doesn't want anybody else to get the credit but himself. He doesn't want to share the credit with the people you know, with the contacts you have, with the money you have, with the reputation you have, with the power you have. See, God wouldn't let Joseph's contact with the cupbearer be the means of his deliverance. Because then Joseph would live his life and give credit to the cupbearer as opposed to giving credit to God. And so God let him get on the edge. He let him taste the sweetness of freedom. And then God slammed the door shut, because when God wants to do his thing in your life, he is not going to share the credit with anybody else, yourself included. He wants to have all the glory. He wants to get all the credit. Paul actually says in 2 Corinthians 1, he says, "We were so utterly burdened beyond our strength that we despaired life itself. But that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but God who raises the dead." And so even Apostle Paul, with his ministry and all those people that got saved through his ministry, even God brought him to this point, that where we may despair life itself because of situations or circumstances, but God does it for a greater purpose than we may initially see. Now, there's a statement that I know you've said and I've said, and we need to correct this statement. The statement is, God will not give you more than you can bear. Raise your hand if you've ever said that in life. God will not give you more than you... I've said it too. That's actually not in the Bible. The truth is, God does give you more than you can bear. And there is a time when God will give you more than you can bear, and the purpose of that is he's trying to shatter you of you. When he wants to break you down of your self-reliance, when he wants to break you down of your self-sufficiency, when he wants to break you down of your independence until there is total dependence on him, that you're relying on him to carry you through this. So one of the reasons that some of us may have not gotten off our detour quite yet is because we are too self-sufficient. We feel like we can handle this situation ourselves. We feel like we know the right people. We have the right experience. We have enough money. We have the right job. And we think because we have this human ability, because we have this human talent, because we have these human contact or these human resources, we're going to rely on that and then give a little prayer in the end to make it a little spiritual. But God will give us more than we can bear, because he's trying to break us down of our independence. It's when God shatters you, right when it looks like he's going to deliver you. But remember, that's good news. And that's the first point, that God shatters us of our self-sufficiency. The second point, to know that God is taking you off your detour to your destiny, is when God prepares you by his providence. When God prepares you by his providence. And most of the time, God is preparing you without you even knowing it. What I mean by that is, if you look with me at Genesis chapter 41, verse 1, we began by reading, "When 2 years had passed, Pharaoh had a dream." Let's talk about these 2 years. At the end of the story, Joseph is 30 years old. He's in jail for 2 years, which means currently he's 28 years old. So he's 28, he's already been 11 years on a detour. It looks like he's finally gonna get delivered. Then the cupbearer forgets his name, and then 2 years passes. Joseph's in his cell this whole time. After the cupbearer left, I would imagine Joseph is sitting there thinking, all right, any minute now. Any minute now, that door is gonna knock, I'm gonna get out of here. Cupbearer is talking to Pharaoh right now. Pharaoh's going to come. He's going to set me free. For 2 years, Joseph has been waiting for a knock that never came. But 2 years later, Pharaoh has a dream. Joseph's never met Pharaoh. Joseph knows Pharaoh is Pharaoh, but he's never met him. He has no connection with Pharaoh or his dream. Pharaoh has gone to sleep, and he dreams, and he has this crazy dream about 7 fat cows and 7 skinny cows and 7 fat ears of corn and 7 skinny ears, and he can't figure this out. There's cows eating cows. There's corn eating corn. I don't know what's going on, and so Joseph is, all the while, Joseph's over here. He's locked in prison. He has no idea what's taking place over here in the palace, and this dream is going to be the link that links up Joseph with his destiny. And God is preparing this dream without Joseph even knowing it. Now, there are a couple words you and I need to eliminate from our vocabulary. Those words are luck, chance, and fortune. Those are not Christian words. You do not find those words in Scripture, because you cannot have a sovereign God who's in control and have luck or chance or fortune. Because that means nobody was controlling the circumstances. Since we worship a sovereign God, who the Bible says not a single hair on your head falls off, which he is fully knowledgeable of. Every single hair on your head, God knows what that hair is doing. If it falls to the ground, he knows it. If it's growing, he knows it. If it's going gray, he knows it. So there can be no such thing as luck or chance or fortune. And there's another word we're going to describe later. That's called providence. Providence. Pastor Tony Evans says providence is where the fingers of God slip into the glove of history. When God's finger slips into history. So the question must be asked, why did God leave Joseph in prison for 2 years? And he did that because God was using 2 years before Pharaoh was ready to have a dream. And God was using 2 years before Joseph would be prepared. And Pharaoh has this dream, and it's this dream. Out of the river of the Nile comes 14 cows, and then the 7 eat the other 7. And he wakes up, and then the next dream, ears of corn come out, and they eat each other and all this stuff. Verse 8 tells us, in the morning Pharaoh's mind was troubled. So he sent for the magicians and the wise men of Egypt. Pharaoh called the professionals, the magicians and the wise men. The wise men predicted the future, and the magicians controlled the future. So you could see why Pharaoh kind of reached out to these group of men. They were the best of the best. And he asked them, hey, what's this dream mean? And not a single one of them could tell him. When God is setting something up, he will not let human wisdom come up with an answer. When God is setting something up, he's not going to let human wisdom bring an answer to it. And so what God is saying here, that human wisdom simply is not going to answer the question that Pharaoh had. And so it's not going to be the normal processes at work. Normally the magician, the wise men, they're really good at their job, which is why Pharaoh called them in. But here God has put a plug on that. This is not possible. Why? Because God has a job for Joseph. A destiny. Preparation. And one of the reasons we also stay on a detour when we should be off by now is we keep introducing human wisdom into the equation. Once you introduce human wisdom into God's equation, you have cut off God's way. Let me put it another way. I don't know if you know this about me, but blooming onions are probably one of my top 5 favorite treats. Blooming onions, you know exactly what I'm talking about. You get them at county fairs, you get them at Outback Steakhouse. You split an onion open, you dip it in batter, you deep fry it, and then you eat it with ranch dressing. It is truly one of man's greatest inventions. But my dietitian, or my wife, tells me that once you eat a bloomin' onion, you have now canceled out the nutritional value of that onion. You see, onions are incredibly nutritious. But the nutritional value of that onion is going to be canceled out by the batter, by the deep frying, and by the ranch that you dip it in to eat it. And you see, a lot of people, they come to church for spiritual nutrition on Sunday, and they go out Monday and dip that nutrition in batter. They dip God's word in the deep fryer of human wisdom. They deep fry it in what I think. They take God's word and they deep fry it in what my friends think, and what the media thinks, and what the culture thinks, and what Facebook and Twitter think, and they keep deep frying God's word and human wisdom, and then they wonder why their walk with Christ is never getting better. And Jesus says in Matthew 15, he says, you actually nullify the word of God by the tradition of man. You nullify it, you cancel it out. You revoke the word of God of its power because you keep deep frying it even though you go to church for the nutrition. So you stay on the detour, and God will not let anything else answer the question that only he holds the answer to. And so Joseph, I imagine, is sitting there in prison just wondering how long. All right, Lord, how long? Which leads us to our third point. The first is, you know when God is taking you off detour to destiny is when God shatters you of your self-sufficiency. The second point is when God prepares you by his providence. And the third thing is when God surprises you by his grace. When God surprises you by his grace. What do I mean by that in verse 9? The magicians and the wise men are over here. They're trying to come up with answers for Pharaoh, and they're not coming it up. And then we read that the chief cupbearer is over here, and he's hearing dream, interpretation, dream, interpretation, dream, interpretation. Suddenly the light bulb goes off in his head, and he's like, Pharaoh, I need to come talk to you. He says, you know, 2 years back, there's this guy in prison, and we were in prison, you were mad at us, so you threw us in prison. We had a dream the same night, and there's a little Hebrew boy there named Joseph, and he interpreted the dreams, his dreams came true. I think you should go talk to him in prison. And just like that, we think, well, it's luck, it's chance, it's fortune that Joseph happened to be remembered in this moment. But it's the surprising nature of God's grace. Providence. When the hand of God moves in the glove of history. God had created that dream. God purposefully allowed the cupbearer to forget Joseph's name, only to remember it 2 years later. God makes a connection so that now Pharaoh wants to meet this boy, Joseph, that he never knew before. And the word quickly comes up in verse 14. Because when God decides to move, often it comes quickly, suddenly. It's on his timeline and not ours. So Pharaoh calls Joseph in. He says, listen, I had this dream. And the cupbearer says, you can help me. Can you help me? And Joseph says something interesting. He says, God will give you the interpretation. I can't do it. God will give you the interpretation. Notice something. Joseph has been in prison for 2 years. He was helpless for 2 years. But by his answer, Joseph was not hopeless. A common descriptor in Joseph's story is the Lord was with him. The Lord was with Joseph. The Lord was with him. I can't help but imagine in the 2 years that Joseph is sitting in prison, helpless to the circumstances around him, is that Lord was there communing with Joseph, allowing Joseph to worship the living God. And so he says, listen, Pharaoh, I can't do this, but my God can. And he says, this is the interpretation. He says, the cows, now there's going to be 7 good years and 7 bad years. And what you want for the 7 good years is you want to store up all the grain so that you can use it for the 7 bad years. Now, this is a little surprising. Because you would assume after 2 years, all the hope in Joseph's heart would be gone because he waited 2 years for a knock on the door that never came. And there may be some of us here that have simply given up because that knock has never came in our life. But then suddenly happens. Suddenly is when God surprises you. It comes out of nowhere. When you could not have guessed it, when you could have not expected it. The truth is, I was on another plane a couple years ago. I was going back to school in Boston. We're going to Kansas City, to Boston. More weather hit. I have terrible luck. Storm is up in Boston, so we detour off and land in LaGuardia. We're sitting on the tarmac in LaGuardia, 15, 20 minutes, couple hours, and then all of a sudden I'm sitting there and I notice the door opens and the stewardess lets a family off. And so I'm sitting there and I'm thinking, wow, they have to get off. I have to sit here. So I grabbed the stewardess. I said, hey, why did you let them get off? She said, well, this particular family was on their way from Kansas City to Boston, in which they were going to get on another plane and come down to LaGuardia. But since a detour brought us to New York, we decided just to let them off where they are now and kind of bypass a detour along the way. And you see, God knows how to create a situation for you, to bring you from here to there and skip the in-between. It's called a surprise, where you're planning on something and God takes out the middle. You arrive at your destination ahead of time because God is full of suddenlies. When you're doing your own thing and you're operating from the worldly perspective, you're going to miss the suddenlies in your life that God is bringing your way. And so we may ask ourselves, and then I'll land the plane of the sermon. How do I practically know? How do I practically know that God is bringing me off the detour? Joseph says later, Genesis 41, verse 32, he says, now as for the repeating of the dream to Pharaoh, twice, the cows and the corn, twice, it means that the matter is determined by God, and God will bring it about. Twice. Let me remind you, Deuteronomy 19:15, that by two or three witnesses, God will confirm a matter. So when God comes through twice, you know it's God. When God does something a second time, you know it's God, because God will always confirm his will. God will always validate his will by two or three witnesses. And he says, Pharaoh, the reason you know it's from God is because he gave it twice. He didn't just give you the cows, but he gave you the corn. You have the double witness. So don't just look at what's happening in your life. Look for the ways God is showing up twice. Let me end with this story. And I've shared this before. I never planned to be on Long Island. This was not a part of my plan. Actually, as I was preparing for my last year in Boston, I was actually interning at the Babylon Church and the Babylon Presbyterian Church for the summer. The summer was ending, and the church came to me and they said, hey, after your final school year, will you come back and work for us? And I said, well, this is a year in advance. So could you kind of give me a semester to think about it, pray about it, talk to people about it? They said, no, we need to know in the next 2 weeks. So I said, listen, there's no way. There's no way. I have school. I'm not even sure about pastoral ministry. I'm a Kansas boy in a foreign land. I said, I don't know who I'm going to meet this next year. They said, you got 2 weeks. I said, fine. I said, well, I'll talk to Jesus about it, but don't hold your breath. A couple days later, my mentor called me. My mentor is a Presbyterian, lifelong Presbyterian. And he said, I hear you got a job offer. I said, how'd you hear that? He said, don't worry about it. He said, take the job. I said, Jim. I said, it's New York. I'm Kansas. It's New York. I don't know about pastoral ministry. I got a whole year. Who am I going to meet? Who am I going to date? I have no idea what my life is going to be in a year. He said, doesn't matter. Take the job. A couple days later, I was scheduled to read Jeremiah chapter 34 for my morning devotionals. I came across Jeremiah 34:3. Jeremiah 34:3 says, you're going to see the king eye to eye. You're going to speak to the king face to face, and you shall go to Babylon. So now I had to rethink my thing. This came out of nowhere. My mentor says, I'm still not sure who told him. And now Scripture is saying that. And then all of a sudden, I have two witnesses. I have the witness of a man after God's own heart, and I have the witness of God's own word. And so that these two witnesses, what they did is they flipped my plans on their head to help me to see that Jesus is up to something, and that because God has a way, God has a way of twisting and steering and turning, and suddenly he comes out of nowhere, and he does it via detours. He doesn't do it on a straight line. And so I'm challenging you today. If you find yourself on a detour and you want to be where God wants you to be, stop letting human wisdom get in the way of your detour. Following the ways of man that contradict the ways of God. And even though I don't know how long your detour is going, I don't know where your detour is located, I don't know when it's supposed to take place, I might expect you're getting tired of it. But I want to encourage you to keep leaning into Christ, to keep your eyes open, to ask him to help you see the ways he's suddenlying in your life. And then Jesus will bring you off the detour into destiny. And he does that when he breaks us of our self-sufficiency, when he prepares us by his providence, and when he surprises us by his grace. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you are our Lord who is risen from the grave. That even right now, Jesus, you are ruling and reigning. That nothing is thwarting your plan. No coronavirus is getting in the way. No presidential elections will hinder your plan. The divide between the Democrats and the Republicans will not confuse you in your way moving forward, God, because you are sovereign, because you have risen from the grave and you are accomplishing your purpose. And God, I praise you that even in your big purpose for our world and in history, that you have a purpose for each and every one of your children. That you love them, and you are working all things out for the good of them because they are called to you. And God, I pray then whatever detours we're running into our lives right now, that you would make your presence known, that by your grace you would shatter our sense of self-sufficiency, that you continue to prepare us by your providence. And I pray that you'd open our eyes to help us be surprised by your grace. We love you, praise you, and ask all these things in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. We're going to be celebrating communion. There is a little portable cup on your seat. I want to invite you to grab that cup. And in it, we know that on the night Jesus was betrayed, he was with his disciples in the upper room. During dinner, he grabbed the bread and he gave thanks and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, after dinner, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks and he said, "This cup is the blood of the new covenant shed for the remission of sins. Do this in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again." So I want to invite you very carefully to grab the wafer and grab the juice, to pull that mask down, hold your breath. The blood of Christ broken for you. And the blood of Christ shed for you. Mask on. Pray with me. Thank you, Jesus, for breaking your body and shedding your blood for us. That we can be made right with you. Give you the glory in this time. We ask all these things for your glory and praise. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
See, here I come, quiet my soul. Remember.
Let's stand.
Redemption's here, your blood. Oh, everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured out. Bring me to my knees, Lord, I lay me down. Rid me of myself, I belong to you, oh, lead me, lead me to the cross. You were as I tempted and tried. Word became flesh, bore my sin and death. Now you're risen, and everything I once held dear, I count it all as lost. Lead me to the cross where your love poured. I belong to you, oh, lead me, lead me to the cross, to your heart.
Shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face to you and give you peace, because the Father knows you and where you're at on your detour, and he loves you anyway. He sent the Son, Jesus, to live, die, and rise again on behalf of you, and then sent the Holy Spirit to keep you connected to the living God as he prepares you for the destiny he has for you. All for the glory of Jesus Christ, since it's in his name we pray. Amen.